the answer form and then we'll start.
Okay, I'll do that. Thanks. Good evening, all. Good morning in some places, I think. Basically, this is the QF1, which is like a solo quiz for QFI members and some outsiders also. Basically, there'll be 20 questions in the quiz. Some have multiple parts, so I'll explain the rules at that point in time. If there are two parts in a quiz, particular question, and you get one part right, because the answer Google form, which I think Vinith has already shared, which is also in the bottom of the slide, https://tinyurl.com/QF5 answer. See, basically, if you are getting either of the parts right, you can mark yourself okay. And if there is only one question, which is having three parts, and if you get two of those three parts, you can mark yourself as yes or no. If you get two of the three right, you can mark it as one. If you get only one part right, you can mark it as no. So that anyway, once you go to the Google Forms, you'll understand that better. So all answers should be typed only in the Google Form link. Please do not share or talk about it here or discuss it anywhere else. Mostly it will be one word answer or a few word answer, which according to the question I will explain to you. So straight away we'll go to the first question. The first instance of such a swearing in happening outside India was in July 2020 when Suriname President Chandrika Prasad Chan Santokhi had amazed everyone after he took the oath of office in this manner. In November 2020, Dr. Gaurav Sharma, MP for Hamilton West in New Zealand, created history by repeating the same thing. So I'm going to show you a particular picture which depicts them, both of them taking their oath. In which language did they take the oath? So I'm looking for the name of a language. This is the question. So on the top, you can see Mr. Chandrika Prasad. In the bottom panel, you can see Dr. Gaurav Sharma, MP of New Zealand. So I'm looking for a very unique way of swearing in, which they took in a particular language. Which language did they take the swearing in? Just toggling back. Visuals.
Karthik, so once you feel you've given enough time, you just let me know. Folks, if you know the answer, you can raise your hand on Zoom and I will pick one of you to attempt to answer. So Karthik, whenever you're ready, you can just let me know.
They will get about 10 seconds. There are probably people who have joined in the middle, so give about 10 seconds.
Sure.
I think a sizable number has already raised their hands. Okay, we'll close it here. Let's take answers. Whom are we calling first?
Yeah, Satish, can you attempt to answer?
Yeah,
Yeah, Sanskrit is perfect. Sanskrit is the right answer. They all took their oaths in Sanskrit. They were the first two, at least people outside India who are actually of Indian origin, to take it in Sanskrit. So if you have written Sanskrit, please mark yourself 1 point. Okay, we're moving on to the second question. Visuals will come in the next two slides, so please bear with me. There are two parts to the question. First part is to identify the country that has issued the currency. Second part is to identify a particular bird, which is the national bird of that currency, which gets its name from the unique feature that resembles a similar feature of a terrestrial animal. So for the bird, I'm looking for a two-word answer. Okay, so X is the country, Y is the bird. Going to the visuals now. This is the currency note. some critical portions have been redacted. Okay, there you can see the birds both on the front and on the back panel of the currency note. And this is the bird itself, a photograph of that particular bird. For the bird, I'm looking for a two-word answer. Okay, toggling back. For the bird, it's a two-word answer. For the country, it's a straight one single country name. So here's the visual again. This is the bird. So probably 10 seconds more and then we'll close the question. Okay, so let's take answers now. Four people have already raised their hands.
So let's have the country first. Paul Pop, do you want to answer and tell him the country alone?
So is this Malaysia and Pied Hornbill?
Can you repeat the second part? Malaysia is right.
Is it the Pied Hornbill? I'm not sure of the species. It could be a crested or a pied. Pied Hornbill, I'm going with pied.
No, we'll repeat for a better answer.
Let's try somebody else.
Okay.
Surendra Pradhan, you answered the name of the bird.
Hello? Hello?
Yeah, go on.
No, my guess was also hornbill. I was guessing hornbill.
It's not just the hornbill. Actually, it's a kind of a different feature which the this particular hornbill is having.
Crested hornbill.
No, not the crested hornbill. Anyone else?
Does anyone else have an answer that is not?
Let's try one more, Harish. Okay. Someone else, yeah.
Let's try Ashwin. Ashwin Chirat, you want to answer?
Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'll go with the Malaysia and rhinoceros hornbill because the orange part looks like a rhino's horn.
Beautiful. The answer is rhinoceros hornbill because it resembles a rhinoceros horn. So give yourself 1 point if you're getting either Malaysia or rhinoceros hornbill. So either of those two is okay. Moving on to question number 3. Basically, I'm looking for something which these people have done over a period of time. It's all started in 1996 when John Blaha missed out because his space flight to Russia's space station Mir began in September and he could not return until January 1997. So as the Washington Post reports, NASA officials collaborated with Texas government officials to pass a particular law. In the fall of 1997, David Wolf became the first astronaut to do it. The law is specific to Texas because most active astronauts reside there, but NASA has said that the process can be done from other states if need be. Most recently, Kate Rubin has done it twice in 2016 and 2020. What have they done? So basically, this is kind of a law specific to astronauts because they go out to space and they miss out something. So they're given this special status. Looking at the way people are raising their hands, I don't think we need to give them time. So we can straight away take answers.
Okay. Arun Prasad, why don't you answer?
Yeah, this is voting in the elections, the US elections.
From? No, I'm looking for, you want to elaborate that?
I mean, from the, I mean, through postal ballot from the space, because they are in the space, they can't vote.
Fair enough. That's exactly what I was looking for. Astronauts voting from space. So voting from space was allowed because of this particular handicap. So they started giving this particular lady also recently, she voted and she put a picture on her Instagram and all that. So voting from space is what I was looking for. So voting from space gives you 1 point. Okay. Moving on to question number 4, it's a double picture. I'm looking for a fictional country house that was named for a marine rope tool, and it's made its first appearance in 1943 in the book series, and it was inspired by this chateau in France. Okay, I'm having a visual of the marine tool also. This is the marine tool on the top panel on the right hand side. This is a particular chateau in France which inspired a fictional country house. So I'm looking for the name of the house, the fictional one. Started in 1943 in the book series, and it went on for a long time. And it's named after a marine rope tool, which is apt considering the owner of the house. Okay, so let's start taking guesses.
Ira Prem, do you want to answer?
Marlin Spike Hall.
Perfect. Marlin Spike Hall is the right answer from Tintin. Marlin Spike Hall, of course, belongs to Captain Haddock, his ancestral house. So Marlin Spike Hall gives you 1 point. Okay, we move on to question number 5 now. Which American company's logo was inspired by this dome in Yosemite National Park, California? So I'm looking for the name of an American company whose logo comes from this particular dome. I hope all of you are capturing all your answers in the tiny URL, because that's where your scores will come from. The link is also there in each slide, in the bottom of the slide in the footer. Okay, so let's start taking guesses.
Kartika?
Paragon?
Not Paragon.
Let's try Narayani Subramaniam.
Is it Mountain Dew?
Not Mountain Dew. Nice guess.
Let's try Gopa.
North Face.
North Face is right. The North Face. You have seen that logo, right? That's actually from here. Okay, so that gives you 1 point if you say you've written North Face. We move to question 6. November 2020, a metallic pillar, very strangely, it was placed 9.5 feet tall. It was discovered in the Red Canyons of Southeast Utah by state biologists. The artifact appears to be made of stainless steel, riveted together in the shape of a triangular prism, dating back to some time between August 2015 and 2016. This is where people were able to date it back because of the satellite photos and all that. So the artifact has been touted by media as actually coming from a particular literary movie set, possibly from the 1960s, from the movie adaptation of that particular literary work. Which literary work or film, both are the same name, are this from? Or is this possibly from? So this is the visual. People started moving there and then they started posting pictures. So that location of this particular place or this artifact is not revealed because people may get lost and end of the day people have to go and be found. So Apparently, it's already been removed from that place. It's like all over the media. So which movie is this was this possibly a set of or a set from? A set prop, whichever way you want to call it. I'm looking for a series of words here, it's not a single word answer, if that helps. 19 participants have raised their hands, so probably we can close it here and start taking guesses.
Jakkula Divya.
Yeah, is it 2001 A Space Odyssey?
Yeah, 2001 A Space Odyssey is the right answer. 2001 A Space Odyssey had that monolith and all that. So this is the same thing. At least it closely resembles that. So people are thinking it is that. So 2001 A Space Odyssey gives you 1 point. Okay, question 7. X is a suspension bridge over the river Ganges, located 5 kilometers northeast of the city of Rishikesh in the Indian state of Uttarakhand. Now, one of the iconic landmarks of Rishikesh, it is often paired with a larger bridge 2 kilometers downstream named Y. The bridges are named after two brothers from one of the Hindu epics. I'll show you visuals. These are the two bridges, left and right. So these are named after two particular brothers from the Hindu epics. What be the names of these X and Y? Very simple question. I think most of you will get this. Toggle back to the visuals. Okay, I think that's time enough. Who wants to go now?
Raghunandan, do you want to answer? Raghunandan Ekwade.
Yes, it is Ram Jula and Lakshman Jula.
Perfect, perfect, perfect. Ram Jula and Lakshman Jula is the right answer. So if you get Ram and Lakshman, please take points for that. If you got Ram and didn't get Lakshman, don't take points, because that's not right. If you have written Ram and Lakshman, take 1 point. Okay, moving on to question number 8. Looking for a name of an organization. From the about page of this organization, it states, because blank, blank, blank would have different acronyms in different languages, our founders decided to give it the short form blank. Blank is derived from the Greek word meaning equal. Whatever the country, whatever the language, the short form of our name is always blank. During the founding meetings of this entity in 1946, the Greek word explanation was not invoked. So probably this is a backronym. So the first three blanks are the full name of the expanded name of the organization. And they wanted to give it a short name, which they said it's the name, Greek word for equal. And considering it will be different versions in different languages, the expanded part, so they decided to go for the short form only. So what is the name of the organization? Probably the shortest answer of the quiz. These guys are on fire, man. These guys are just answering everything. And then people, when they are just posting the question itself, they're raising their hands. I think this quiz will get over in another 15 minutes at this rate. Okay, let's take answers now.
Vidula, do you want to answer? Vidula?
I think she's having some problems. Can you move on to someone else, Harish?
Varun Reddy, you want to answer?
Yeah, is this the International Standards Organization, ISO?
Yes, this is International Standards Organization, ISO is the right answer. ISO, they just wanted to make sure, you know, people don't goof up their name by expanding it in different ways. Russian will have a different way of doing it. French people will have their own ways. So they said ISO is our name. ISO means equal. So ISO gives you 1 point. Moving to question number 9. What is unique about the navies of these particular countries? Azerbaijan, Bolivia, Central African Republic, Kazakhstan, Turkmenistan, Laos, Mongolia, Paraguay, Rwanda, Uganda, Hungary, Burundi, Ethiopia, and the list is kind of exhaustive in this sense. So what is unique about the navies of these countries? Wow, 10 people have already raised their hands. I think there's time enough. We'll go to the answers.
Asta, do you want to answer?
Hi, sorry. These are all the navies of landlocked countries.
Yeah, these are landlocked countries and they don't have a coastline. So imagine that they are having navies and all that. I don't know what for what purpose they're actually having those navies. But interestingly, they're having navies and they're having huge investment for all that. So landlocked countries will give you a point. Okay. Question number 10. So we're going to have a long answer with 3 slides more to go. Those are visuals. So I'm looking for the name of a particular film, which is also the name of the exhibit. Susanna Greaves is the curator of this ongoing art exhibit, November 2020 to January 2021. She drew inspiration for her Blank Blank, which is the name of the movie and also the name of the exhibit. And it's an inaugural show in the White Cube's new online viewing room. She explains it as follows. The exhibit is an invitation to consider how artists construct scenes and suggest narratives, use cinematic devices to tease our innate voyeurism, and how they explore and challenge the idea of the gaze, which a 1950s film was instrumental in formulating. Okay. So I'm showing you 3 visuals which will come in 3 slides. This is the first of the lot. This is one of the paintings. The second one. And this is a kind of a prop, which they want to pay direct tribute to that movie. So this is also part of the online exhibit. So I'm going back again, slowly. So I'm looking for a 2-word answer, which is the name of the movie and also the name of the exhibit. So which 1950s film are we talking about? Okay, let's take answers now.
Yeah, there's a question if the blank sizes are indicative. Do you want to answer that before then?
Yeah, blank sizes are indicative, yes.
Abhinav, there, do you want to answer?
Yeah, is this Hitchcock's Rear Window?
Can you be a bit louder because I can't hear you?
Hello. Hello.
Yeah, can you repeat your answer?
Yeah, I said, is this Hitchcock's Rear Window?
Yeah, this is Hitchcock's Rear Window. Perfect answer. Rear Window gives you 1 point. Rear Window by Alfred Hitchcock. Grace Kelly and I think... Okay, so Rear Window gets you 1 point. We're moving on to question 11. According to the author, this is a three-part question and this is the only three-part question. My apologies to Raju also. I promised him no three-part questions, but I have one of those. This is the only one. But it helps that X and Y, X and Z are related. Okay, so if you get X, most likely you should be able to work out Z. Okay, and it was very clear in my mind from the beginning that the formula was to, from X, X is series of teen detectives from the 1940s and Y. The problem is when I pitched this to my editors here in the US and said that the book is going to be X plus Y, they both said, who is X? X is British and I assumed she was popular in America, but it turns out she wasn't. So instead, in the middle of the pitch, I said, instead of X, think the Z gang, because it's pretty much the same thing. Two boys, two girls and a dog. The only difference is that the Z gang were old enough to drive and X's characters weren't. So it was pretty much works out the same way. So that's when I started pulling in Z elements as well. So I'm showing you a visual as well. This is the name of the book, Meddling Kids. That also might help. The Meddling Kids by Edgar Cantero. Okay, X is a British author. I think the gender also is known, very well known there in the question itself. Y is an American horror fiction writer. And Z is a group of TV characters known by a single name. Okay, so this is the book cover. So you can see two girls, two boys, and a dog. So basically the author says, X also has two girls, two boys, and a dog. So does Z. So instead of wondering about X, let's wonder about Z. So give me X, Y, and Z. If you give me two parts right, take full points. If you get only one part right, there's nothing. But if you get all the three, again, it's only, we can't give you more than one. So it's only 1 point. Okay. Any have answers now?
Nibadrita Saha.
Hello, am I audible?
Yep.
Okay, so the answer is any Blyton plus H.P. Lovecraft. Blyton is the British author and Lovecraft is the American horror fiction author.
Okay. Want to try Z?
Actually, I have no idea about that.
Let's get someone else for Z. Anmol, do you want to try Z?
Hi, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Scooby-Doo.
Scooby-Doo is right. So that's the trick, Troika. And in Blyton, H.P. Lovecraft and Scooby-Doo. So if you get either of these, two of these three, you get to 1 point. If you get all the three, still you get 1 point. If you get only one, no points. So mark yourself accordingly in the Google Forms. Okay, we'll move to the next point. It's about the Ashes. It's basically about the Australian cricket team. So no, let's not look at the Ashes part. So since the Ashes 2019 series, the test shirts of Australian cricket teams, both the men's and the women's teams, features a piece of artwork by Fiona Clark on the collar. This particular artwork symbolizes Australian cricket history that began with a group of people who began playing cricket in the late 1860s. So first part is, which group of cricketers does the artwork commemorate? Second part is, which venue? Possibly one of two. There are two answers because in some sources it's giving a different answer. So I'm accepting either of those two answers. Where the group played one of their first games of cricket that the big circle represents. So I'm showing you a visual This is the artwork which you will be seeing in all these matches and all that. So India is playing Australia, you will find this being in their collar. So that is the expand or the zoomed version of that on the left. So it's signed by Fiona Clark, 2016. So first part is which group of cricketers does this artwork commemorate? Second part is which venue? So once again, we are accepting one of two, either of those two. So if you get one part right, you'll get points full. Okay. I hope all of you have written down the answers.
The question is, this is an actual cricket venue.
Sorry?
There's a question if this is an actual cricket venue.
In the second part, you're asking? Yeah, those are actual cricket venues. See, basically the circles represent the grounds or the venues. The sticks represent the stumps.
Okay.
That's the symbolism of that particular artwork.
Meena, do you want to try?
Hi, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah, I only can attempt one of the part of the answers. The group of cricketers is Aboriginal cricketers. I'm not sure of the venue though.
All right, we'll wait for the venue part from somebody else.
Malcolm Finn.
Hi. The venue is Lords. So the Aboriginal cricket team toured Lords and they played a match there. So this basically represents that.
Okay, we'll give it to you for Lords, but there are some conflicting sources which are saying it is MCG. So basically, the first part is correct. Aboriginal team that toured England in 1868 is correct. Second part, either of Lords or MCG is okay. So in ESPN, I got the thing as it's Lords Cricket Ground. But other sources are also saying it is MCG. So it again depends on who's right.
So Karthik, there's a question on whether indigenous will do instead of Aboriginal.
It's okay, take points. The Aboriginal is the indigenous group of ethnicity of Australia, but anyway, it's okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So mark yourself for that. We'll go to the next one. There's two more visuals which will come up in the next two slides. Question number 13. Designed by Daniel Lipskin, this memorial in Ottawa, Ontario is dedicated to the victims of which horrific set of events of the 20th century? So there are two visuals which will come. Is one of the visuals. Okay, this is the second one. Kind of an aerial view of the whole thing. So I'm looking for a one word answer. Victims of what? I'll leave it here. Okay, 8 people have already raised. 9. Okay, let's start taking guesses.
Abhishek Chaudhary, do you want to try?
Yeah, the answer is Holocaust.
Holocaust is right. the Holocaust. So if you've written Holocaust, please take points. Question 14, looking for a Hollywood movie name, which again, you might derive from the next slide. The image in the following slide depicts a 5x5 square made up of 5 5-letter words, each a 5-word Latin palindrome. A 2020 Hollywood movie described as a quantum Cold War thriller alludes to this palindrome square and takes its name from the middle word of the square, which means to hold. This is the square. So if you can work out some keywords from that, you may be able to work out the answer. There are some things which are blanked, of course, the middle part of it. So 2020 Hollywood movie gets its name from, or probably was inspired by the whole thing. And considering that the palindrome thing is there in the entire movie, so it's a kind of a key feature of the movie. Okay, let's take guesses now.
Anantha Shankar.
Is this Tenet?
Tenet is right. Tenet is by Christopher Nolan is the movie. Most likely didn't do well because of the whole pandemic and all that. But then one of the movies which very rarely bombed, Christopher Nolan movie, very much anticipated. Tenet is the answer. If you get Tenet, T-E-N-E-T. And if you go back to the visual, if you say S-A-T-O-R is the first word, E-R-E-P-O is the second word, Tenet is the third word, Opera is the fourth one, and Rotas is the last one. Okay, so Tenet is the correct answer. Tenet gives you 1 point. Moving on to question number 15, it's about a breed of dog. This breed of dog of the Spaniel type derives its name from the French word for the characteristic look of this fringe and long hair on the ears. Give me the original word in French or its English equivalent. So if you can see the visual on the left, it may really help. So either the French word or the English word. All dog lovers should get this. Wait 5 more seconds. And guesses, please.
Neil Kumar.
Yeah. Is it Epagnio Francia? Francis?
Can you repeat that, please?
Is it Epagnio Francis? F-R-A-N-C-I-S?
No, 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 no. It's not the answer. Anyone else?
Surendra Papia?
Is it Siju? Hello?
Hello?
Can you hear me?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, I am guessing Siju.
Can you spell that out? Okay, never mind. It's not the answer. Who's next?
Kartika, you want to try again?
Yeah. Is it Papillon?
Papillon
or butterfly in English?
Papillon or butterfly. Either is okay. it looks like a butterfly, so it's called the papillon breed, and it's also in English we call it the butterfly. There's another word which comes from papillon or the butterfly, which is in English again, and we use it in cricket. You guys want to have a stab at it? Free for all, anyone try? Three people have raised. Anyone want to try?
Hi, Sajit here. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
It's the pavilion?
Yeah, the pavilion is correct. The pavilion is the other word, which comes from the butterfly again. So, question number 16 is about architecture or sculpture. Caryatid is a sculptured female figure serving as an architectural support, taking the place of a column or a pillar supporting an entablature on her head. What is the name for a male sculpted statue which serves as an architectural support? The probably two answers are there. You can give me either of those two answers. This is a visual. So male figure which is carrying the whole thing on his head, almost at the top of all these kind of buildings, is called a what? Or is named after whom? Okay, who's going first now?
Anyone's answered. Asta, do you want to try again?
Hello?
Yeah, hi. One of the names is an actress.
Okay, you want to try the other?
I have no idea about the other.
Okay, anyone else for the other one? One is Atlas. I'm sure all of you got Atlas. Atlas carries the whole world on his shoulder and all that. There's one more gentleman from the same mythology.
Arun Prasad, do you want to get the other part?
No, I only had Atlas.
Atlas is a more obvious one. There's one more.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I also had only Atlas.
Suhas, do you know the other part?
Is it Hercules? Hello? Can you hear me?
Can you repeat your answer?
Is it Hercules?
No, not Achilles. Achilles didn't.
No, Hercules.
Hercules, no, not Hercules. Hercules briefly did it from Atlas, but then it was not Hercules.
Yeah, I think we will move on.
Okay, we'll move on to the answer. Telemon or Atlas. So if you get Atlas, please take points. Telemon was the father of Ajax, if you remember Ajax from the mythology. Okay. Question number 17 is again a two-part question. It's about a TV series which is currently running. Just give me one sec. So basically, X is the name of a TV serial which is about a chess opening, named after a chess opening or a chess strategy. And Y is actually a child prodigy who was a real life person. Even though it's not based on a real person, it kind of mirrors the whole thing about this person. His life and the whole TV series is kind of mirroring each other. So the people are really wondering, you know, conspiracy theories are always there, that probably this is the kind of a female version of this guy. So these are the TV series is what, this is the kind of a timeline of the TV series. The real life person's timeline also is mentioned on the right side. a lot of similarities are there. This is the chess strategy, kind of a visual representation of the thing. So there are two parts here. One is the name of the chess strategy, which is also the name of the TV serial. Second part is the name of the real person. So as I said earlier, either will give you points, provided you get one right. Okay, we'll start taking guesses.
Anirudh Krishnan.
Yeah, hi. So X is Queen's Gambit and Y is Bobby Fischer.
Perfect, perfect. Both points are correct. Both parts are correct. The Queen's Gambit and Bobby Fischer. If you got Bobby Fischer or the Queen's Gambit, please take points. If you didn't get either of those two, please mark yourself as no. Question number 18. This serif typeface designed in 1989 by Carol Dombey for Adobe is based on the lettering used for the inscription at the base of the Victory Monument, which the typeface name takes its name from. Now, Dombey, she created the design taking inspiration from a full-size picture of the inscription. It has since been used on almost every other movie poster or TV poster. This is a kind of, if you can make out, it's almost all Roman capitals. So I'm looking for the name of the font, which is also the name of a particular Roman emperor. So it's a simple one-word answer. Okay, we'll close it here and start taking guesses.
Sunil?
Sunil, could you unmute yourself and try to answer? Yeah, go ahead, Sunil.
Formally, no, I would like to pass. Yeah, thanks.
Okay. Okay, Gopala Krishnan Vaidyanathan. Gopala Krishnan Vaidyanathan, can you unmute and then talk?
Hello?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Octavius?
No, that's not the right answer. Nice guess.
Let's take one more guess, Harish.
Abhinav, you were the first. Try your
hello.
Hand.
Hello. Yeah, hello.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay, this is Trajan, the Trajan column.
Trajan, yeah. Trajan is right. Trajan is what I was looking for. Trajan after Trajan's column. Now, Trajan will give you 1 point. Either is okay, Trajan column is also okay. Okay, penultimate question. When the senators were asked to announce the third overall selection in the NHL's 2020 virtual draft, instead of seeing team general manager Pierre Dorion, Beers experienced a surreal, dream-like sequence of a distinctly famous and beloved Canadian who proceeded to announce the senators' draft pick in his own signature way. Answer. Our category today is NHL, and here is the clue for you. With the third pick in the 2020 NHL draft, the Ottawa Senators chose this player. Question. The correct response, who is Tim Stutzel, who made this cameo one of his last? So we're looking for the name of a Canadian TV personality who's not associated with the NHL generally, but he was asked to do a cameo. And he did this virtual draft sometime in October 2020. In his own way of doing it. So he says our category today is NHL, and here's a clue for you. And he goes on to say the correct response, who is Tim Stutzel. Okay, can we have answers now?
Who's Bindya's Datta? Bindya's Datta?
Okay. I don't think he's able to answer. Pick someone else, Harish.
Ashwin Chirat.
Hello, this is Alex Trebek of Jeopardy.
Perfect. Alex Trebek of Jeopardy. Unfortunately, he passed away about 2 weeks ago. Alex Trebek is right. Okay, Alex Trebek gives you 1 point. We'll move to the last question of the quiz. Filmed over nearly 3 years, this particular documentary titled Blank Blank, the length of the blanks are indicative, follows renowned artist Big Muniz as he journeys from his home base in Brooklyn to his native Brazil and the world's largest garbage dump, Jardim Gramacho, located on the outskirts of Rio de Janeiro. Now name this documentary that evokes a 20th century poem, the last words of which might set your mind at peace. Possibly because the quiz is over, hopefully not, possibly. Okay, this is one of the visuals. This is of course The Death of Marat by Jack Lloyd David, which has been reproduced in his own signature way. So what is the name of this particular documentary, which is also a 20th century seminal poem? He has gone to this largest garbage dump in the world, and he's like gone and picked up a lot of things, and he's done his artwork. Very weird way of doing it, but he's done it. Let's wait 5 seconds and then we'll go to guesses. Come on, guys, last question. 6 participants only. Try. There's nothing, no harm in trying. Yes. Okay, we'll stop here. Start taking guesses.
First? Sunil Kumar, do you want to finish things off?
Yeah, am I audible?
Yeah.
It's Wasteland.
Wasteland is perfect. Wasteland. It is, of course, the T.S. Eliot poem. Wasteland.
I think.
With Shanti, Shanti, Om Shanti, Shanti.
Correct.
And that's the way the quiz also ends. That hopefully everybody is at peace. Everybody thank enjoyed you. The quiz. Thank you all for coming in good numbers. Thank you all for coming from various places. Thank you so much, Raju, who couldn't be here, who actually wanted to be here. Vinit and Harish, patiently he did everything for us. He picked up people, did everything for me. Thank you so much. Ashwin, you did the guinea pigging for me. Thank him also so much. And without him, he made a lot of changes to the quiz. He helped me out. So a lot of thanks to him also goes out to him. And all of you who came today, thank you so much. Hope you enjoyed the quiz. Hope to see you soon, some other way. All right.
Thank you, Karthik, for putting this together.
Thanks a lot. Thanks. Thank you. Bye, guys. Take care.